subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
There is nothing else on our heads but coronavirus. It's also sitting heavy on our hearts because all of us know of somebody who has suffered, is suffering, and some of us have had family members also who've suffered. Many of us have also lost family members. So this is a true national emergency. We can talk about this all the time, and I have my colleagues talking about this and writing this on the print.in, so please check it out. So of the 300 or 3,000 or 30,000 aspects that we could talk about, I am picking up three today and talking about each one briefly. First of all, there is clear evidence now that irresponsible behavior, not just our as a people, we have been irresponsible as a people, but also of our government and election commission and some state governments, has contributed to things going out of control. And I will show you evidence. Number two, we'll also explain the new vaccine policy, that the government has come up with, which I welcome, but about which there are a lot of questions, there is a lot of confusion, and government has once again failed as yet to explain what it means. All it does, on the other hand, is that you have government spokesmen, from ministers to other social media warriors, just unthinkingly attacking those who criticize the policy. It's important to put the facts out. So I will try and put the facts out today, particularly as one of the companies, the biggest company in India, the biggest in the world, Serum Institute of India, has put out its prices for the private sector and for free sales to the state governments. And third, I will also briefly talk about the problems that India's vaccine manufacturers are having because of the ban on exports of crucial components of vaccines by the Americans. So first of all, look at the first graphic. Now, these graphics we had also used in the story that we carried on the print.in by Mohana Basu. Graphics are by Ramandeep Kaur. You can see that story also. I'm sharing a link with you. If you see that first graphic and see the headline of the graphic, it is quite self-explanatory. It tells you, you know, when people say graph has gone up and down, you say the graph is flat, the graph has collapsed. You also say the graph is rising like a hockey stick. So graph, you can say rising sharply, rising at 45 degrees, rising at 60 degrees. But sometimes when it rises like this, like at 90 degrees or perpendicular, then you say it's a graph like a hockey stick. You know what a hockey stick is like? It's like this at the bottom and then it goes up like this, vertical. So if you look at this West Bengal map, this tells you that over the past month, that is generally between 20th March and 20th April, the numbers of corona positive cases in West Bengal has gone up 1500% or 15 times. And that's when in Bengal, testing is quite poor because state government's capacity for testing treatment is poor. It has not built it. It's also a poor state. It's also a state where the entire government is caught in electioneering, as is the central government. And the fact is that the Election Commission has been insensitive to this, first of all, in the sense that when they could have, they did not collapse these campaigns or these voting days instead of eight phases. Second, they did not issue firm enough instructions to stop these rallies, to also ensure social distancing. The orders that they issued applied only after 7 p.m. or 6 p.m. or something. They were nonsensical. They were a joke. They were a joke, and they were a cruel joke on the people of Bengal. And you know, this virus does not recognize international borders. How does it bother about interstate borders? So from Bengal, it will travel out. It has traveled out. And from other states, it will travel to Bengal. So until a couple of days back, central government leaders, the Home Minister, in fact, 3 or 4 days back, even the Prime Minister, were holding public meetings with a lot of people there. In fact, just as the number of cases and the number of deaths and were going up, and just as cremation grounds and graveyards were running out of space and time and personnel, you saw this madness going on. In fact, that's when we used a line from one of the chroniclers in Emperor Alexander's conquering armies that came to India. And one of his chroniclers noted with great surprise at what kind of a country is this India, that on the one side there is a battle going on. Alexander's army and Porus's armies were fighting. Adjoining to that, farmers were plowing their fields, villagers were leading their lives as normal. Nobody seemed to be bothered. So the same thing has been happening in our country. And as we might have paid for this attitude in the past, when the invaders came, we are now paying for that episode now. So while a lot of the country was burning with coronavirus infections, we continued pushing with this election, boom, boom, boom. Elections and also Kumbh Mela. And somehow this idea was spread, that Kumbh Mela is not spreading the virus, that elections are not spreading the virus. And people threw data at you, see, Tamil Nadu, it hasn't gone up that much, they had elections. Kerala, it hasn't gone up that much, they had elections. Assam, it hasn't gone up that much, they had elections. Now, each place might have different factors, but the fact is that many of those elections took place much earlier. By then, India did not have such a heavy coronavirus infectivity situation. Now we've done it, this Bengal election we've done when the fire was already raging. And there is a price to pay. Of course, people who collected these rallies, people who made these noise, they will not pay this price. Innocent people of Bengal and then of adjoining states and the rest of India will pay a price. Now, if you see similarly Kumbh Mela, people said, but Uttarakhand has very few cases. Uttarakhand is a chota state, tiny state. People in Kumbh Mela do not go from Uttarakhand. As few go from Uttarakhand, but a lot come from Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Hindi heartland and Gujarat, they are the biggest contributors of pilgrims to Kumbh Mela. Now, you will not see those numbers in Uttarakhand because these people will go back home and there are lakhs of them, in fact, more than a crore of them who've come there and who've gone back. We saw one train at Ahmedabad station which my colleagues Sonia Agarwal and Praveen Jain covered, and they mentioned how 22 passengers coming off that train out of about 300 something people were tested positive even with rapid antigen tests at railway station. And rapid antigen tests can miss about 50%, at least 40% of the cases. So these people are going back to their villages, they are going deep into the countryside and they are taking the quote unquote gift of the virus. Now, this virus is not a prasad from any religious ceremony, from any religious festival, from any shrine. This is nonsensical and this is criminal and this should have been stopped. In fact, the Kumbh Mela should have been called off earlier. What the motives were, I don't know. And I've always learned in my life that don't jump to conspiracy theories until whatever has happened can be explained fully as total stupidity. So let's say allowing Kumbh Mela was total stupidity. Haj hota hai to Kumbh Mela bhi hoga. Dekho, tablighi aaye the to Kumbh Mela bhi hoga. Agar iftar ke din log Hyderabad ki masjid ke bahar khade ho rahe hain to Kumbh Mela bhi hoga. Arey ab karti rahi hai na, because the virus has no religion. I say this for the 10th time now, that the virus is the only truly secular being in the world. Secular to the extent of being irreligious. Secular to the extent of being probably that even Stalin wasn't. Because at some point Stalin would have said, maybe when the Germans came when Stalingrad seemed to be falling, somebody would have said in his group that, "Arey, Bhagwan aake humko bachao." But not the virus. The virus is waiting for those who are relying on God to save them. And I will tell you once again, it's a message that has to be repeated again and again, that God does not come down to help those who are not taking care of themselves or who are being irresponsible. Gods are very powerful, but gods are not underemployed. God or gods, whether you believe there is one or there are many, they have a lot to do. And I don't think they put on their top priority looking after people who decide to be stupid, particularly be stupid in the name of God, or in this case also in the name of politics. So evidence from Kumbh we will start seeing over the next 15-20 days. Although we have seen already that Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, the numbers are rising rapidly. In fact, once again, I will share the graphic from you. You will see that the R number, that is number of people each coronavirus positive person infects, is now the highest in India in Bihar, 50% higher, 1.5 times the national rate, very close to that in Uttar Pradesh and then Jharkhand. These are the heartland states, and then Rajasthan and the others are not far behind. These are the heartland most populous state, Uttar Pradesh and Bihar and Rajasthan. If you add them all up, they are more than 40 crore people. So this virus is now gone and spread there, and then add Madhya Pradesh and the rest. And you have then West Bengal on fire at the other end. Now, if you look at West Bengal, I showed you the first graphic going up like this. Then you, I see you, show you graphics for some individual districts. And these are districts which have gone to the poll on different dates. And you can see that this pattern of rising cases has continued through this month of campaigning. And after the polling day, it has shot up even more, because 15 days before the polling day, or 3 weeks before the polling day, you saw the most intense campaigning and public meeting. And remember, this virus takes anything from 1 week to 2 to 3 weeks then to infect people. Also, the first lot to get infected will then infect others. So the peak impact you will see in about 3 to 4 weeks. So I would say that, you know, once again, sort of negatively, that you ain't seen nothing yet. It's an Americanism. Maybe it was spoken then in a positive sense, but today I am saying, in terms of the calamity that has befallen Bengal, you ain't seen nothing yet. So see South 24 Parganas. Elections took place of 10th of April. Previous 15 days to the election, it was already rising, and then it began rising like this. Nothing that tells you that election campaign did not lead to a shooting up of these numbers. Purulia, voting took place on 27-3. See how from that point it takes off, and even 15 days before the polling, in the most intense phase of the campaigning, you start to get this increase. But once again, it takes a week, 2 weeks for the numbers to show up, because in any case, a human being, once exposed to the virus, takes anything between 5 to 7 days before showing any symptoms or getting tested, and you need a couple of days also for the test result to come in. So you can see, if you see everything with a 15-day lag, you know that this wave in West Bengal is the election campaign wave. Similarly, this wave in the Hindi heartland is the Kumbh Mela wave. You can say 100 things to try and deny it. You can quote Uttarakhand figures to me when the story is in Uttar Pradesh. I am not fooled. You are not fooled, I am sure. And definitely the virus isn't fooled. The virus is having a party. Or these days, you don't even like to say party. People prefer to say what is that? Party, right? So the virus is having a party in the Hindi heartland in Bengal. Look at other districts of West Bengal. Look at Howrah. Again, 10-4 is the polling. See what's happening to the graph 15 days before the polling and after the polling. It's going up like that. Hooghly, 13 April is the polling. You see how it's been going up before the polling during the campaign season, and then how it picks up after the campaign polling. It is not that these numbers have gone up because people have gone out to poll. That will show 15 days or 3 weeks later. These are numbers that are now beginning to reflect the peak days of the campaigning with a 7 to 21 day lag. North 24 Parganas, again voting on 19 April. You can see already the impact, again 15 days before and now. And I told you about the state. So this is the story. This is the story. Now I know that there are people in this government and also people close to the government who say, hum kya kare, hamari janta hi bewakoof hai. Our people are stupid. So I have a very dear friend in Pakistan, Pakistan's finest columnist, Khalid Ahmed, who once told me when we met in 1984 for the first time, the first Pakistani I met was probably the smartest. And he said to me, ke, aap galti karte ho, partner, ye soch ke, ke humare hukmaran corrupt hai. You make a mistake by thinking that our rulers are corrupt. Sachai ye hai ke humare awam corrupt hai. Our people are corrupt, and because our people are corrupt, our rulers are corrupt. So in this case, rulers, because people will be the way the rulers are, yatha raja tatha praja. So in this case, you find people close to the government, people in the government saying people are to blame. But what cue were people being given by the government? The same government, the key ministers, the Home Ministry, which is supposed to be actually the guardian of National Disaster Management Act, whom they were collecting crowds for his rallies, for the Prime Minister's rallies. So if they were doing it, why would anybody stop? And why would people stop? So don't blame the people. Otherwise, you have to turn that, go back to that old equation and say, elect a new people. The people are the people and they get the cue and they act on the cue. So that is one part. The second part is the controversy over the vaccine plan, the new vaccine plan and the pricing. And why I say it's a good plan. It's a good plan because we are a country of 138 crore people. To vaccinate all of us is a big deal. America started in mid-December. Even until now, America has done brilliantly. Even until now, only 50% of Americans, that's about 18 crores, 17 crore Americans, 20 crore Americans have been vaccinated, which means a lot of them have had two shots. But I'd say about half of America's population of just about 30 crores, 33 crores, has received one shot. So it takes a long time, which means you need a lot of production. You need a lot of production. You also need a lot of delivery. So you can't say that this delivery will only be done by the government. Most of us don't rely on the government on anything but, okay, public health. So government should do as much as they can and the private sector should also do as much as they can. This is an all hands on the deck situation. Second, should the government give it free or can people pay for it? Now there are many vaccines now that this has opened up. Now think about it in public health terms. If the government starts giving you a buffet of vaccines and you'll say, will you take this or will you take this? Everybody will say, I want the most expensive one. So there are limitations to how much any government can spend. So what has been done now is a hybrid policy. This is not Sweden, right? This is not Denmark. We are a little bit bigger than Denmark. I see these stories when people get hassled that Denmark has stopped AstraZeneca. So should we also stop AstraZeneca or Covishield? To which my answer is Denmark's total population is 59 lakhs. That is less than one third of Delhi's population. These days our vaccination drive is moving very slowly, just about 29 lakhs, 30 lakhs a day. That is the average. But even on these lousy days of vaccinations in India, in 2 days we can vaccinate the entire population of Denmark, right? So this is a very big population. Those who can afford to pay should be allowed to pay and should be made to pay. So the pricing that Serum Institute has today announced, and I suspect Bharat Biotech will be similar, is that state governments buying the vaccine will pay 400 rupees per dose. That means for a two-dose vaccine, 800 rupees. At what price the state governments then give it to their people or they give it to free is up to the state governments. Second, private hospitals, when they buy these vaccines, they will pay 600 rupees for each dose. That means for two doses, 1200. And then they can put on it the markup of their costs, their syringes, their service delivery charges, their profits, whatever, because they are private hospitals. After all, when you go to All India Institute of Medical Sciences, you get the best doctors in the country. You don't pay a rupee as consultancy fee. But when you go to your neighborhood GP also, particularly say in South Delhi or many most parts of the country, even if you go to your neighborhood GP, you might end up paying 2000 rupees or 1500 rupees or 1000 rupees as consultation because that's private. Similarly, even in a village, your primary health center or civil hospital will charge you nothing for consultation. But when you go to even a neighborhood doctor or half a quack also, you will have to pay 5 rupees, 10 rupees, 15 rupees, 20 rupees. So India is a hybrid system. You should pay in the private sector. That doesn't bother us. The problem arises or the question arises on lack of equity between the center and the state. So a lot of people, particularly in the Congress, are saying if the center is getting at 150, why are the states getting at 400? That is a valid point. But I would put one little caveat there that government, central government has already bought more than 10 crores, about 15 crore vaccines from these two Indian manufacturers, that is Serum Institute and Bharat Biotech, of which 13 crores have already been administered. I think remaining 2 or 3 or 4 crores, whatever remains, will now be administered by the 30th of April. There is still 9 days left in this month. As that is done, because they've given an advance, a supplier's credit of 4,500 something crore rupees, 3,000 crores to Serum Institute of India, the rest to Bharat Biotech. The general presumption is that the price at which central government is getting these vaccines, they have placed an order of about 20 crore more vaccines with Serum Institute of India and about 12 crores with Bharat Biotech. Now, that with that in the bag, you still have a lot of vaccines, and government of India, state, central government says they are going to distribute these free until July. And beyond July, they will place further orders. So you now have three kinds of vaccination services in India. What the one is totally free, that is central government funded. Second is at a lower price, that is the state government funded, but state governments can give it free, but it will cost them more money, which is a lack of equity. But I'm coming to that. And third is the private sector, where people can then choose, mere ko to Moderna chahiye, mere ko to Pfizer chahiye. I need Pfizer with a little bit of perfume on it. If your hospital gives it to you, fine. Or you can also say that I'll go and get my Pfizer or Moderna or Sputnik or whatever in a place which has a coffee machine. So you pay for all that. That is different. Leave that aside. Now the question is the lack of equity between the center and the state. Now the center has made a monopoly bargaining. They've essentially fixed the price for themselves to these manufacturers and said, we want this much for free distribution. So that is a price fixed for free distribution. The center has incentivized these manufacturers by paying them ahead. Otherwise, to get money out of the government is very tough. And I will tell you an honest and cruel truth. Every newspaper, every media organization in the country which gets government advertising actually maintains third-party agents who know the art and craft, don't ask me more, who know the art and craft of getting money out of the government for government advertising. It's very difficult to get money out of the government. In this case, government has paid this money ahead. It's a supplier's credit. On the promise of this, on the guarantee of this, these manufacturers have been able to raise resources from the market, raise resources from banks. They've been able to borrow the money. In fact, Aadhar Poonawalla or Serum Institute has already said it. So this is a three level of pricing: free, cheaper price, that is state government, and then the free market price, where the private hospital can procure anything. This is also a way of incentivizing the manufacturers, so they can make, while they might sell at no profit to central government or at a low profit to the state government, they can make some surpluses elsewhere to invest in greater production, because India is going to have to produce more than 300 crore vaccines in the next 15 months. Because remember, India's population of 138 crores, even if 100 crore are vaccinated, 200 crore doses only India will need between these two or three manufacturers. So that is the pricing situation. So once again, you will have the choice of whether you want it free, whether you want to pay something, or you want to pay more and be in a more comfortable environment. And I think this is a reasonable arrangement. And finally, you are hearing these stories of the ban that the Americans have put on exporting a lot of the components, raw materials. Raw materials sounds a little crude, but components that go into making vaccines. Now, a vaccine usually has 3,000 different components or pieces of machinery that are used. Plastic bags, filters, enzymes, cell cultures, because after all, if it's an adenovirus, you can't catch so many chimpanzees and take out their viruses and suddenly give them all common cold and take out virus from them. You have to replicate these viruses in the lab. So you need cell cultures. A lot of these are then sourced from many countries. America is one of the major sources of these. What the Americans have done is that Trump had invoked something called the US Defense Production Act. U.S. Defense Production Act was first promulgated or drafted in 1950 during the Korean War. That was to ensure that U.S. military continued to get all the supplies they wanted. This act gives American government the power, one, to limit what can be exported and what must be sold domestically to this federal government there, the central government there. And second, it also empowers them to give incentives to manufacturers of these priority goods. So that is what this law is used for. Trump had used it mainly for ventilators at that time, because at that time there was a lot of clamor for ventilators and desperation that unless lakhs more ventilators became available, a lot of people will die. Over time, ventilators lost quite a bit of that oomph, so many were not needed. But the same law, then again Biden, when he took over in January, on 21st of January, just as he took over, he invoked the same law to put restrictions on export of vaccine components and essential parts as well, raw materials as well. That is what has caused delays in vaccine production in many parts of the world, including in Europe, but especially in India, because India is the vaccine factory of the world. And both Adar Poonawalla and Dr. Krishna Ella of Bharat Biotech have said that this will delay vaccine production, particularly of the kind of volumes that India needs to produce, not just for itself, but for the COVAX program, to which America has also contributed $4 billion, but also now for other export commitments. So Novavax, for example, it's a protein-based new vaccine, which Serum Institute of India has to produce in India for exports and also use in India. 20 crore vaccines have to be produced at least this year, but that will be delayed and stockpiling will suffer. So last week, our Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar spoke with his counterpart Antony Blinken. His tweet said that among things they discussed was also our health cooperation. US State Department's readout was a bit more specific. It talked about health cooperation in areas of COVID-19 control. So obviously the right buttons have been pushed there. US government has now responded, saying that while they give due consideration to India's needs, they will put their domestic priorities first. It is not very helpful, definitely not very helpful for the most powerful, the richest, the biggest country in the world, and also a country which now has produced so many vaccines and vaccinated so many of its people and has actually placed orders for vaccines almost 4 times more than its population needs. Soon America will be awash, drowning in surplus vaccines. So this does not seem like a very sensible policy. However, governments take time admitting that there's been a mistake and correcting it. So I draw some optimism from another part of the statement that said that we will do the best that is possible and we are looking at the situation. So these are the three aspects I thought I'll talk to you about on this ongoing pandemic.